Hi, everyone. Welcome to the second session of the Spring Environmental Resilience Speaker Series, jointly presented by the Indiana University's Integrated Program on the Environment and the Environmental Resilience Institute. I'm Lingxi Chenyang, Environmental Law Fellow, and I'm so pleased you were able to join us today. Both IPE and ERI are founded on the understanding that interdisciplinary learning and research are essential to teach today's scholars and to solve today's problems, not to mention tomorrow's. The natural sciences, the social sciences, the humanities, and the arts are all critical and in play as we tackle climate change and the environmental challenges that are affecting our health, our communities, and our economy here in Bloomington and around the world. So IPE was founded in 2012 by the provost and the leadership of the O'Neill School, the College of Arts and Sciences, and the School of Public Health to bring together all the environmental and sustainability scholarship across various schools and departments on the Bloomington campus. ERI was founded in 2017 as part of the IU Prepared for Environmental Grand Challenge. Its mission is to enhance resilience to environmental change in Indiana and beyond by accurately predicting impacts and effectively partnering with communities to implement feasible, equitable, and research-informed solutions. So IPE and ERI faculty, staff, and students have worked together to bring us a full semester worth of speakers. Over the course of the semester, our speakers will address a wide range of topics from resilient agriculture, which we'll do today, in the face of climate change, to advocacy and energy transition, to the development of an anti-racist science of ecology, and more. We meet bi-weekly for this series on Fridays at noon, and the next installment will be occurring on Friday, March 5th at noon with Marianne Hitt from Zero Club, so mark your calendars. So you can find information about each talk on the ERI and IPE webpages and in the regular newsletters and upcoming events notices that our organizations regularly send out. And we encourage you to sign up for our newsletters so you'll get reminders about these upcoming talks, as well as other news and events that we publicize. If you have ideas for people we should consider for a future talk, please tell us that too. Finally, logistics on how you can engage with our speaker today. You can put questions into the chat box as you think of them. We will monitor them throughout the speaker's talk, and there will be an opportunity for questions at the end. So at long last, please let me introduce today's speaker, Lixin Wang. Lixin Wang is an associate professor in the Department of Earth Sciences at IUPUI. His research areas include biogeochemistry, eco-hydrology, and isotope hydrology. So before joining IUPUI, Lixin worked as a researcher at Princeton University and the University of New South Wales. He has published more than 140 research articles in international journals. He served as an associate editor of the Geophysical Research Letters from 2011 to 2015. Is an editor of Hydrology and Earth Science System Sciences, and is an associate editor of the Journal of Air and Environment and Journal of Hydrology. He's also a recipient of the prestigious NSF Career Award. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Professor Wang.
All right. Let me share my screen first. All right. Thank you, Lingxi, for the nice introduction and for the invitation, and thank you all for coming. Before I start, I just want to acknowledge the intellectual contribution from Dr. Stephanie D'Arianto and Dr. Pierre André Jensen from Earth Science Department at IUPUI. Pierre is a colleague in my department, and Stephanie is a former postdoc in my group. Most of the research funding I present today will be based on her work. So the research interest in my group is mainly ecohydrology. Essentially, I'm looking at the three-way interaction between vegetation dynamics, soil biogeochemical cycle, and the water cycle. So I'm interested in this three-way interaction ranging from individual plant scale to ecosystem scale to global scale. And the three-way interaction is influenced by climate change from various angles. So we particularly pay attention to the climate change impact on the three-way interaction. Prior to Indiana, my main research interest is in the natural system. So for obvious reasons, after coming to Indiana, my interest shifting to the agriculture ecosystem. But quickly, I realized the natural plants and agricultural plants are quite different in many ways. So one of the interesting part is how less diverse of the agricultural plants are. So as we all know, there are about 200,000 species, flowering species on Earth. And we only use very small proportion of that for our food. So basically it's only less than 0.1% of the species has been used for food sources. And out of the 300 species we use for food, 17 species actually account for 90% of our food supply. So, and also if you think about the main food source, the cereal species, like the wheat, the rice we eat, that's actually only four major species, they can count up to 70% of our food supply. So that's it's definitely a very interesting statistic to me in terms of how diverse and less diverse of the agricultural plants we use for our food supply. As we all know, agriculture system is very sensitive to climate variations. So we know drought will hammer agriculture yield and also heat stress will also reduce the yield of agriculture production. And also a recent study show flooding actually could have a similar magnitude of impact on drought. On agriculture production as well. So this is the impact of climate on agriculture. At the same time, we know agriculture itself actually has a strong feedback to climate and to the environment. So if we only think about the physical aspect, so we know if you cut down all the forests and convert that to agriculture field, and because the land will have a higher albedo, so higher reflectance, so that means it will actually cooling down the surface. But if you add the biological component, if you cut down the trees, you actually remove all the transpiration from the plants, because transpiration is actually cooling force of the land surface. That means you potentially will increase the surface temperature. But more importantly, the agricultural impact on the environment is actually the biogeochemical part. So we know agriculture is actually a big player in terms of the greenhouse emission. So it's one of the major player for CO2 emission, but actually is the largest producer for N2O emission as a global scale. Because N2O is the number three greenhouse gas in terms of their radiative forcing, in terms of their capacity to warming the climate. So that means agriculture is actually a very important player to affect the global climate. So not only agriculture change the climate, it actually also have a big impact for environment. So we know agriculture is a major source of a pollutant into the local water bodies and also the coastal area. So both in terms of both phosphorus pollution and nitrogen pollution, they actually has an important role to actually impact the environment. So in today's talk, essentially I will talk about the two-way interaction between agriculture and the environment. So I will talk about the climate impact on agriculture. Essentially, I'm focusing on the drought impact on agriculture. And also I will talk about the feedback of agriculture to the environment. So we know drought is one of the natural occurring meteorology condition. So it's happening in any climate zone. It's hard to predict. And drought tend to become as a gradual phenomenon, and then suddenly it can cascade into a very devastating disaster. So that's kind of the characteristic of drought. And also we know based on the meteorology record, people think the drought frequency, so there is overall drying trend as a global scale, and the proportion of land that actually suffer from extreme drought has been increasing, so almost 30 times. And we also know in Indiana, in recent history, we have several major drought that actually has a significant impact on agriculture. So that's why we need to better understand the drought impact on agriculture. And in this talk, most of the research results I will talk about is using a statistical technique called meta-analysis. So I just want to quickly mention about this this technique. So essentially for meta-analysis, what we do is we go to the primary literature. We actually digitize the data from the published literature. And then we synthesize the data using statistical method. So the advantage for such method is you're actually working with a very large amount of the data that's actually cover different species, different climate, different soil condition. So you can actually quantitatively synthesize the effect of certain things you are interested. So that because of a large amount of data set is actually increased the precision and the power of your synthesis. And also because a certain impact could have a different results in different literature. And you can actually synthesize and make sense why they are different by using a large amount of data. So that is a central method we're using for today's talk. FAO, Food Agriculture Organization, actually classify our food into three major groups. The bigger group is the cereal group. The second largest is the legume group. Then we have a tuber group. So in this talk, I will look at the drought impact on this group separately. So first we'll look at the legume group. So that includes the soybean and like a peanut. So things like crop like that. So there are two major groups of legume, pulses and non-pulses, and we'll look at them all together. So because I have used similar figures, I will just quickly go through what this layout of this figure. So basically the x-axis is observed yield reduction in response to drought. And each bar here represent one single crop species, and the length of the bar indicates the 95% confidence interval of that response of that species to drought. And if the two bars overlap with each other, so that means their drought response are similar. They are not statistically different from each other. And if they are if they don't overlap with each other, that means their response are significantly different. And on the y, on the right part is a similar figure, but is observed water reduction. So basically the water treatment part. So this part really just to tell us how severe the water reduction is. So because most of them are overlap with each other, they are in a similar range statistically. So most of the results I will talk about is on the left hand. So basically we're looking at the species specific response. So the key message here, you can see, you know, across all the legume species, there is a wide range of drought response. For some species like a black gram, so it's very sensitive to drought. So it's actually the drought, the yield reduction up to 80%. And for some species like groundnut, that's peanut and soybean, so they have a much less drought response. So their yield reduction is only about 30% and some is even 20%. So basically there is a huge range of drought response across different species. So one of the reasons we think that happens is related to their root nodule. So as we all know, one of the unique feature of legume species is root nodule. So essentially that is a symbiotic relationship between between plants and the bacteria, soil bacteria. So, and there are two major groups of root nodule. One is indeterminate, one is determined. For indeterminate, basically for the plant roots, they have the meristematic cells. So that means the root nodule can keep growing. So that's why most of the root nodule in this group actually are elongated one, because the roots actually keep growing. And for the another group, for the determined one, there is no basically a cell can grow anymore. So really they can just become bigger, they can't grow more. So that's why the shape is more like a round. And but more importantly, the major difference between these two is for the determined group, they are very sensitive to drought. So when water stress comes, the nitrogen fixation rate will actually dramatically reduced. So that's actually will translate to the yield reduction. So that's why for green gram, black gram, like with what we saw here, they actually show very sensitive. They are very sensitive to drought. So the only exception is soybean. So because this one has goes through a lot of hybridization and a lot of genetic modification, so they actually, we can actually improve their drought resistance. But naturally, I think this is a major reason for the wild spread of the drought response. So besides species, we can look at the phenology response. Essentially, we are looking at the drought timing. So during the the drought can come from the vegetative stage and come from the later reproductive stage. And we want to take a look at how drought timing will impact the yield response. So what we saw here is when drought come as a vegetative stage is actually the yield damage is actually not very severe. But when the drought come from the reproductive stage actually is devastating. So that the range actually is very large. And that's actually the same pattern we saw for three major food groups. So on the vegetative stage is okay. And for the late reproductive stage, the impact is actually quite severe. So that is the phenology impact. And also then we will look at the soil factor. So basically, if the same drought come, if the crops grow on different soil texture, how that will actually impact the drought, the crop production. So what we saw here is for the coarse and the fine soil, they are on the comparable range. But for medium soil texture, we actually saw the drought impact is actually much larger than the other two groups. So we know medium soil texture soil essentially is a is good soil for plant growth. They can grow. It's because of the water and oxygen and the nutrient transport is pretty good in medium soil, texture soil. But also that means when a drought come, they actually have a pretty big impact on the yield reduction. So that is basically the legume group. And then we look at the cereal group. Cereal group is the largest food group, so that include maize, rice, so the common food we eat. So the major difference you saw here is different from legume group. Actually, the cereal group, their range is much narrower, and also the number is actually much lower. So the reason is for cereal group, most of the species are come from the grass family, and naturally, they have a much deeper roots, so they tend to be more drought resistant because they can actually access deeper soil moisture. So that's one of the reasons. But they do also show some species specific response. So one of the reasons is that we know different crop here has a different photosynthesis pathway. For example, wheat has a C3 pathway, and for maize has a C4 pathway. And also they do have a different flower arrangement, for wheat, for example, the female and the male organ actually is in the same flower, and the maize actually have different flowers, so a different flower. So that's actually also contribute their species specific response to drought. So on the right, basically the water treatment, again, we don't need to worry about that. It's basically showing the water treatment part is similar. So because cereal has a actually large group and we have a large data point from this, so we can actually then look at not only the drought response, but also look at the species drought sensitivity. So I mean drought sensitivity here basically is per unit yield reduction divided by per unit water reduction. So basically here, x-axis is water reduction, y-axis is yield reduction. So you can get a ratio based on the slope. So if we put our slope all together, we can see actually there is a range of drought sensitivity for different cereal species. And the interesting one is actually the one at the bottom, wheat and the maize. So they are the basically top two crop species we actually use in our food system. And also the another interesting thing is you can see actually maize here show very much higher sensitivity compared to wheat. So that is interesting because maize is actually C4 plants. So C4 plants, because of their photosynthesis pathway, they can use water very efficiently. So, but here what we see is even they are using water efficiently, doesn't mean they are drought resistant. They're actually more sensitive compared to wheat. So that is actually surprising in terms of the drought sensitivity. So lastly, we look at the tuber group. So tuber basically means things grow below ground, like potatoes, sweet potatoes, things like that, or cassavas. So, you know, we know tuber actually, you know, not a major food source here in US, but it's actually is a pretty major staple in many parts of the world, like such as Africa. So it's actually pretty major food source in different parts of the world. So here, what we saw here is for the tuber species, they actually also has a pretty wide range of their drought response. So some actually has a pretty high reduction in responding to drought. And some, like a potato, is actually much less response to drought. So for two species, potato and sweet potato, because we have a bigger number, we can also quantify their drought sensitivity. So again, yeah, essentially we have the observed water reduction, then we have the observed yield reduction, we can make the slope of their drought to calculate their drought sensitivity. So what we saw here is actually sweet potato tend to have a higher drought sensitivity compared to potato. So this is also a surprising result because if you talk with farmers, most people tell you sweet potato is a hardy plant. It's actually pretty good in terms of responding to drought. So the results showing here that tell us basically when we talk about certain species are hardy, drought resistant, very likely we're talking about their survival, not really the productivity. So basically means even sweet potato have the higher chance to survive water stress, but actually they will reduce their productivity or yield dramatically in responding to drought. So you can't actually equivalent survival to productivity. When we put all three together, all three major group together, cereal, legume, and tuber, when we put them into the same scale. So first of all, we can also see for cereal, they have a narrow range and they have a smaller yield reduction. And for tuber and legume, they have much wide spread. So like we mentioned, the one of the major reason for the observed changes like this is due to their plant characteristic. So like root structure. So like a cereal, they have a deeper roots compared to other groups. But also is actually related to the how much research we actually has been conducted for different group. So we know, for example, when we do the drought related searching for cereal, legume, and the tuber group, we know the cereal group is actually 4 times larger than legume, and then almost 10 times larger than the tuber group. So that's actually tell you how much study in the literature, how much study has been done to actually improve their drought response, drought resistance. And also another thing related to that is because for cereal and for legume, they are mainly from one family for this group. And for tuber, they actually come from several families. And that's also contribute their spread in their drought sensitivity. So this basically just kind of a summary of the drought response for different crop species and show you the species specific response and also how phenology and also soil texture will impact the crop response. So we saw basically cereal is more resistant to drought compared to other group. So that's contribute not only to the plant species, the plant characteristic, but also contribute by the number of studies contribute to the drought resistance. And also what we show here is for other species, when drought come into the late reproductive stage, is actually the impact is actually very severe. So this basically tell us from the management point of view, the timing does matter. So if you have a drought coming at a later stage, you should pay more attention to the earlier stage. But also we also show the soil texture did play a role in the legume response as well. And also based on the results, especially from maize and wheat results, what we saw is sometimes water use efficient plants like maize doesn't mean they are drought resistant. And also based on the comparison between the sweet potato and the potato, we can say sometimes when we talk about certain species are drought resistant in daily life, doesn't really mean that will translate into productivity. It's more means that they can survive the water stress, but they actually, their productivity or their yield will be significantly impacted. So, you know, to basically minimize the drought impact on productivity, so we can focus on plant breeding, so basically improve their trade in terms of drought resistance, but also we can actually focus on the agricultural practice to basically minimize the drought response. So some examples could be schedule the irrigation timing. So, you know, for example, if the drought come in the late stage, you make sure you will compensate for that. And also some practice like mulching, like no-till could also reduce the drought impact on agriculture yield. So I give you two examples. One is the mulching, one is actually the no-till response. So the mulching practice is one actually commonly used in many parts of the world, mainly in China. So what people does is, you know, they have a plastic covering a ridge, and then the two adjacent ridge will create a furrow. So you can plant plants here. So the ridge actually will collect water. We actually collect rainwater or put water here. So in the furrow part, you can either leave it bare, or you can put some straw as mulching, or you can actually have a continuous plastic as mulching. So only make a hole to do the planting. So we basically compare the yield response, water use efficiency response for different treatment. So we use rainfall agriculture as a control, and then we compare the response from plastic mulching and the straw mulching and also the bare furrow part. So here is the quick results. We basically look at four things. One is the soil moisture change, one is the yield change, one is the water use efficiency change, and one is the evapotranspiration change. So mainly I was focusing on the irrigation part and the plastic mulching part. So basically we can say compared to the rainfall control, both irrigation and the plastic mulching actually can increase the soil moisture significantly. And also these two are actually almost comparable. So, and the same thing for the yield. So basically both of them has a higher yield compared to the rainfall agriculture, but also irrigation and the plastic mulching almost have the same yield. At the same time, when you look at water use efficiency, you can see plastic mulching actually has a much higher water use efficiency compared to irrigation. And that is caused by a higher evapotranspiration through the irrigation treatment, because the mulching essentially will reduce the evaporation dramatically, almost eliminate the evaporation. So that's responsible for the increased water use efficiency. So the key message here is essentially the mulching, the plastic mulching almost can function as the same role as the irrigation. So you actually have the same yield, but also you actually save water. So you have much higher water use efficiency under this treatment. So that will be very good for the drought response. So that is one practice. So another practice is no-till. So we all know no-till is one of the conservation practice across the globe, especially in US. So we saw no-till field in Indiana quite commonly, right? So essentially you don't cut down, you don't take away the plant residue after you harvest, you leave them on the ground. So that will actually help the ground to prevent soil erosion. And so that's actually has a big impact into the carbon sequestration and soil erosion. And also based on the another work, collaborative work, what we show is for no-till, you can actually increase the yield for drier environment. So we know a lot of people talk about one of the downside of no-till is the yield change, basically reduce the yield as a global scale when you look at all of everything together. But when you separate them into different climate regions, you can see actually no-till has a positive impact on yield. And in the dry region, we also show in the dry years, they actually do improve the yield as well. So that's actually, so the reason is because the residue will actually protect the soil moisture loss. So that's actually helped the plants through the water stress conditions. So that's a good thing. So that's another practice we could do to improve the plant-water relationship. But at the same time, what we saw is no-till actually increased N2O emission. So that's actually not necessarily a good thing, right? Because of N2O is a powerful greenhouse gas. So that is one feedback no-till could have for the environment. But also what we want to know is the second part of my talk is really the no-till impact on the water quality aspect. So basically there are mixed results in literature about the no-till impact on water quality. So some show no impact, some show actually can no-till can reduce the nutrient loss from the agriculture field, but also there are many studies showing that no-till actually can increase both phosphorus and nitrogen loss. So we want to take a look if we actually sample large amount of data from very diverse environment, what the overall trend you actually can see based on the large scale data synthesis. Here is a reminder of the no-till impact on agriculture in terms of both above ground and below ground. So we know no-till impact on soil has multiple impact in terms of because we left the plant residue on the ground, so they can serve as a physical obstruction to flow. So that means they can reduce surface runoff. So the consequence, they reduce surface runoff volume. And also because of the no-till has an impact, especially long-term no-till, they can actually make soil more compact. So that actually means they could potentially increase runoff volume. And because no-till has an actual contribution to soil organic matter, so that means they can basically increase the concentration of certain nutrients either through runoff or through the vertical part through leaching. And also no-till, long-term no-till will create a micropore. So that means they will actually increase the volume of water flow vertically. So because sometimes you have an opposite effect. So basically then when you look at the no-till impact on nutrient leaching, and you have to consider all of them together and look at the net effect. So here is the overall result for phosphorus and for nitrogen, for nitrate. So we have a concentration and the load here. And in this particular case, they are very similar. So concentration really just the unit per volume of water. And load, you actually use the concentration, then multiply by the volume of water, get absolute amount. So in this case, we saw overall no-till didn't have a significant effect on nitrate when we consider both surface runoff, like horizontal direction, and the vertical direction, leaching. So there's no effect. And but it does increase this zero line. So it does increase the dissolved phosphorus leaching from the agriculture field. So this is overall results. When we break down different nutrient species, for example, when we break down the nitrate into two directions, one is a horizontal surface runoff, one is a vertical leaching. So what we saw here is the intermal concentration. No-till actually increase the concentration of a surface runoff. So this makes sense because you have more plant residue, they can actually decompose and contribute to nitrate. And for leaching, we actually didn't see it's a difference in terms of a concentration. But when we look at the load, actually we saw overall load wasn't different between no-till and conventional no-till. That means even no-till increased the concentration of nitrate because of the physical obstruction of the plant residue reduced the volume of water. So that means the total load wasn't different between the conventional and the no-till practice. But on the other hand, we can say the leaching load is actually increasing under the no-till condition. So that means even no-till didn't change the concentration of the nitrate in the water, but because of the increased the micropores, increased the flow of water. So they will actually increase the overall load from the agriculture field. So when we look at the phosphorus, this time we break down phosphorus into three major groups, total phosphorus, particulate phosphorus, and the dissolved phosphorus. So the concentration and the load are similar in this case. So basically we saw in terms of the total phosphorus and the particulate phosphorus, so no-till doesn't really change, is actually reduced the phosphorus loss from the agriculture field. But for dissolved phosphorus, is actually significant increasing the dissolved phosphorus loss from the agriculture field. Because we know dissolved phosphorus is actually more important in the environmental contact because they can use by algae and other things and cause algae bloom and other environmental issues. So so that's why no-till introduce higher dissolved phosphorus loss from the agricultural field is actually not good thing. So also we then break down the agriculture, the loss for both phosphorus and the nitrogen into different climate region and into different climate condition. So first we look at the climate region. So we basically separate different the region into dryland region and the non-dryland region, humid region. So what we saw here is for both phosphorus and the nitrate, for both load and the concentration, essentially under the dryland, you actually saw there is a significant increase of nutrient loss from the dryland part. And also when you look at the different from the same location from the different years, you actually can see if we separate the years into wet years, normal years, and the dry years. So you can actually see the nutrient loss from the dry years is actually significantly higher than the wet year or normal year. So what that means is basically the potential nutrient loss from no-till is greater under water stress environment, either in dry year or in dry region. So that is important because that has important climate change implication. That means if in the future, if you have a more variable rainfall, like you know, have the basically like a dry period and then come from the wetter period, you tend to have a higher nutrient loss from the agriculture field because based on the microbial response, biogeochemical rate, if you have a drier stage and during the drier stage, they tend to have a lower rate, but when you have the wetting, immediate wetting after the drier part, their biogeochemical rate is even higher than the normal rate. So that's actually can increase the nutrient leaching following dry and wet cycles. So that just means if the more the increasing frequency of a drought will impact the nutrient problem even higher in the future. So the quick summary for this part is when we talk about the agriculture pollution, nutrient impact, we have to separate the impact from concentration and the load. They are not necessarily telling you the same story all the time. So, and also we show that no-till is very important in terms of preserving the soil, reduce soil erosion and sequestering soil carbon. But in terms of from the nutrient aspect, it actually has a limited impact. It's thus helpful for the particular part because of physical obstruction of a node of the residue, plant residue. But in terms of the dissolved part, like nitrate and the dissolved phosphate, it actually can increase the nutrient loss from agriculture field. And also, what we saw is with more frequent drying in the future, the impact of agriculture on the water pollution could become even more severe. So then, if no-till, you know, as one of the foundational conservation practice, if not very effective in terms of water pollution, what we do next? So what we propose is basically you have to combine with no-till with other conservation practice. So that's one of the major practice candidate is the cover crop. So essentially, if you have a conventional system, conventional no-till system, you have the, you know, the high fallow period without crop, and that on one hand has a large nutrient leaching to the environment. And also because of the nutrient leaching, you tend to have a higher denitrification to the atmosphere. So contributes to the N2O. And if you actually then choose different type of cover crop, especially you can compensate the different cover crop traits, you can actually then effectively remove a majority of the actual nutrients that's actually reduce the leaching, but also reduce the N2O emission. So that's why we have that's the kind of the foundation of a new USDA grant we received to actually looking at the long-term impact of a cover crop in terms of greenhouse emission, in terms of nutrient leaching, in terms of the yield resilience. So we will have a four-year observation period looking at the climate variability on all these parameters and also make future predictions of the impact of no-till on agriculture. So to quick summarize what I have today, essentially I'm talking about climate variability, especially drought, significantly threatened agriculture yield. So that's not surprising, but we also show that different species, different soil, and different stage of drought, different phenology stage could significantly change the drought impact. So we have to keep that into consideration. And also we're talking about agricultural practice, even some of the conservation agricultural practice still has a large environmental impact. So that's why we have to think about multiple agricultural practice and integrate them together to be able to not only increase the agricultural resilience to the climate variability, but also to minimize their environmental impact. So I guess with that, I just want to thank our funding source from USDA for two grant on this and the Schoenberger Foundation to support my postdoc. And also I want to thank for my group members for their contributions, intellectual contribution for various part of the research. So with that, thank you all again for being here, and I'll be happy to answer some questions and hear your feedback and comments about the research. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Wang. That was a really fascinating presentation of your very interesting research on no-till agriculture. I know that's been a hot topic in regenerative agricultural policy in those circles. So we have one question from Sawyer Hitchcock. He asks, I recently came across a statistic from the city of Bloomington that less than 1% of food purchased in Bloomington is farmed locally. How important is agricultural localization and cultivating community resilience to climate change?
Yeah, that's a great question. I guess, you know, we Yeah, I guess agriculture was always locally and only like from the industrialization. Yeah, only I guess recent decades we've become more like commercialized, like large scale operation. So I think, you know, from the food resilience point of view, it's always to have, I guess, the local food to be, you know, that's reduced transportation costs. That, you know, reduce, that have a higher like a freshness of the of product is more healthier. So, but from the from the larger scale, from the when you think about the economical point of view, like when you think about the cost and the benefits and doing the local agriculture and versus larger scale agriculture, probably the large scale agriculture has a reason, and it's just more efficient to produce things like that. But I think the local food could be a very good supplement to the large scale. Probably won't be able to, I guess, replace the large scale agriculture.
Yeah, I think that's especially true in the Midwest, where we have a lot of large scale commercial agriculture. So I had a question about, there's another question from Enrique. There's a bill in the Indiana State Senate that could help establish a carbon market infrastructure in the state, and it could also happen at the federal level. What would you recommend the strategy for managing overall climate-friendly farming? What would that look like? What should it focus on?
So that's definitely a great question. So I think one of the missing point, missing incentive is actually for cover crop. So, you know, from the farmer's point of view, especially a lot of progressive farmers, they know the impact of cover crop, you know, long time ago. You know, some of them actually has been practicing them for many decades now. So, but the adaptation rate is very, very slow. So one of the reason is essentially a lot of people, they will have the misconception. They will think because cover crop, when you grow something else on the ground, they will compete with the cash crop, and they will actually reduce the yield, reduce their income. And that could be true for some cases, but some cases also you can see the cover crop can increase the cash crop yield. But more importantly, you know, cover crop has a pretty good environmental impact on the positive environmental impact. I mean, that part is hard to put a dollar sign on that. But at the same time, I think, it's very important to actually incentivize people to actually doing that. So essentially, you know, if you do something good for the greater good, and you should be basically you're rewarded for that. So I think for the policy side, there definitely should have some incentive to, help people to do the adaptation, because they are true. You know, whenever you adapt a new practice, you need actual cost, you know, different probably machinery, different things. And anything can be helpful to have people make that decision will be useful.
Right. I have a follow-up question on that. So it seems like cover crops and no-till offer a more environmentally friendly alternative to just no-till in some places in the U.S. Do you know of any places in the U.S. where that combination yields net negative environmental results?
For example, for the combination, I am not sure, but for no-till itself, because if you go to some places like very cold, right, like Minnesota, so you know some places, you know, the plant residue don't really decompose fast enough. So the if you do the no-till, the plant residue accumulation will be there will be a lot of accumulation, and that's not necessarily for the plant growth. Not good for plant growth. So, definitely, I'm sure there are places the combination is not good. But I guess, for places like this, sure, if not good for no-till, you can't do the combination. But But I mean, from the theory part, it's hard to say like there are obvious drawback because no-till Wang's downside is actually the nutrient leaching part, and the cover crop can actually compensate that pretty effectively. So something I didn't talk about is herbicide and other things. We did some analysis, meta-analysis on the no-till impact on the herbicide. So, for some of the herbicides, it definitely can increase the leaching loss as well. And, a cover crop potentially can also compensate for that, can actually reduce the leaching of the herbicide to the environment. So I would say, yeah, I'm sure it is possible based on the climate condition, but overwhelmingly, I would say, yeah, the benefits will definitely be much larger than their downside.
Yeah, as a follow-up to that question, Megan asks, what are some of the best cover crops to use? Does it depend on the cash crop you're trying to grow, or are there kind of generalist cover crops that are good for no matter what cash crops you're growing in other parts of the season?
Right. So yeah, based on what we saw is the legume cover crop actually are pretty good. So I guess, yeah, that is a definitely case-by-case situation. Case-by-case could be, large scale, definitely. But still, yeah, it's based on the situation and based on the climate region, based on the soil texture. But based on the analysis we have, like a legume cover crop is working pretty well with the cereal species, like with maize. So they actually can effectively reduce environmental impact and doesn't really impact the yield much. So I guess, but yeah, that is a pretty like a region by region type of question. So sometimes you have to try it out,
Okay, so this is a question from the crowd, which is in a little bit different direction. So the question is, there are only two main crops in Indiana, corn and soybean. Why not increase crop diversity? Also, corn is one of the worst plants for soil erosion and water retention. And I'll add on to that question that I was really curious about the drought resilience of crops that were not part of the legume, cereal, tuber categories. So tree-based crops like fruits and nuts and fungi crops like mushrooms. I was wondering what the drought resilience of those crops might be.
So you're talking about compared to the tuber to okay. So I guess if we go back to the results, the cereal one, actually, they are actually compared the all three major groups, the cereal group, actually they are tend to be the more drought resilient or drought resistant group as a whole. So for example, the maize is okay, but yes, if you go to wheat, that's even better in terms of the, the drought resilience. So that's true, but I guess, agriculture, is definitely a commodity, right? People need to make profit out of it. So, whenever you change a species, change operation, there will be a lot of cost involved. So I can imagine, and also, you have to have people to buy, you tend to grow certain crop and build a relationship to sell them. And, suddenly if you change that, that may not be easy to do, but it doesn't mean we shouldn't do that. Especially when we think about the climate change impact for some species, actually, there are more frequent drought and flooding combination for Midwest as predicted in for like future climate. We do need to think about some of the adaptation in that sense. Like, for example, some plants like sorghum, right? So they are pretty drought resistant as well. So, but they have low market value. So I guess, from the economy part, agriculture practice part, that's one thing, but also another important side is the economy. So how farmers deal with, both sides. So from my point of view, it's only from the environmental side, you can't, but you know, the most important part of a farmer set is the economy. So I guess whenever any situation, any decision you made, you have to consider both. So yeah, it's definitely a great question, a complex, but yeah, there will be a very complex answer how to really do that.
Yeah, that's right. And yeah, it seems like no-till and cover crops might be the most economically feasible option for especially Midwest agriculture, given what's already in production. But there's a lot of, you know, tree-based and mushroom-based agriculture on both sides of the coast, like in on the West Coast and on the East Coast. So maybe in the long term, we can transition to more diversified types of agriculture. So this is another question, comes from the crowd. How does the research get relayed to the farmers who are actually making the decisions? And is that connection currently pretty strong, or is there improvement needed in how to communicate that information so that the best practices are actually being implemented?
That's definitely a great question. I guess that's always a good question for any research, but especially for agriculture research. So I would say, because right now the funding we have is based on the essentially statistical analysis based on the literature data, but we do actually have some field-based observation, and we're actually working with the actual production system. So because IUPUI is not land grant university, we don't have our own experimental farm, things like that. So actually all the experiment we do is actually working with a real farmer, and we actually got they basically generously give us a piece of land. We can do some observation. So I guess in that sense, we do have some connection with the actual community. And we also do work with a center called Earth and Center for Earth and Environment, CEES, at IUPUI. So they do a lot of outreach activities. So we work with them on some materials. They present them into the Indiana's the annual activity in the fairground. They actually do some presentation, but also they have a booth for that. And also we work with them, they will develop some education module. They actually present that to the grade school student, try to help them to understand the link between climate variability and agriculture and what practice we can do to help the environment. So we try do some of the outreach, but it's never enough for sure. That's something we're always hoping we can find new ways to improve the conversation, because sometimes it's not one way street. You can't assume what you found is actually always right. You actually can learn a lot from the farmers. Like I mentioned, cover crop idea is not something new, right? It's actually people has been practicing that for some time. It's a two-way street. You can actually learn from the farmers for a lot of the knowledge.
Right. Yeah, that two-way street is so important because farmers are really at the forefront a lot of these climate changes, and they're having to adapt first and foremost. So this is our last question before we close, and it's a really interesting one. Comes from Sawyer. Do you anticipate shifts in typical middle class diet as events such as droughts and big rainfall events increase this century? Might we be forced to shift food habits to more drought resilient crops, for example, on a large scale? And is this feasible? And just looking at the slide that you have up, I'm familiar with corn based products here in the Midwest, as well as wheat based products, but not sure what I can make with millet or groundnut or field pea. Do you think that we need to transition to these more drought resilient crops maybe in the future?
Yeah, I think, like I mentioned, in the first slide, the most striking things to me is really the less diverse of, in general, how agriculture plants are. I guess there is a reason, because you want things to be efficient. I think there should be, but there are only, certain limit. Slowly we should, especially for the the frontier of the, you know, because even when you think about Indiana, the climate change impact is not even. So there will be like a hot spot compared to others. So I think especially for the ones we predict that will suffer the most should actually start experimenting some of the transition. So it's not easy, but I think that will be beneficial in the long term.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to all the new food that we can try with a variety of these crops instead of, you know, just corn or just wheat. So thank you, Professor Wang, for that wonderful presentation. And we will see you all in 2 weeks for the next presentation. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Lingxi, and thank you all for being here and for the wonderful questions. All right, we'll see you.
Bye-bye.